When it comes to providing food for an expanding world population, our seas are one of our most precious assets. And yet every year, we're pushing them further and further towards the brink of collapse.
It's an absolute desert. I just wasn't prepared for this.
We're losing diversity. We've seen catch rates decline to about 10% of the level of the 70s.
2 years ago, I launched my fish fight campaign to try to do something about it.
Join the fish fight!
I found out about the outrageous practice of discards.
I think I just saw 90%+ of all that beautiful fish go over the side, dead.
And thanks to your fantastic support, we are on the verge of changing these crazy EU rules. But throwing away perfectly good fish is not the only mad thing happening out in our seas.
The amount of krill on this conveyor belt is absolutely staggering.
All around the world, aggressive fishing methods are destroying our marine habitats.
My God.
And taking with them any chance of fish stocks recovering.
It's been dynamited so often that there are simply no fish left.
So I've decided to open up a new front in my fish fight campaign.
It beggars belief.
And this time, we're going global.
Who wouldn't want to conserve this?
I want to persuade our governments to future-proof our oceans.
That's incredible!
By setting up networks of marine protected areas all over the planet. This is an even bigger fish fight.
What could possibly go wrong?
Ooh. And more than ever, I'm going to need your help.
I'd like to hear a big cheer from you.
If we work together, we can make a difference to our oceans that will last for generations. In Britain, we love our seafood. But decades of overfishing mean that now our fish stocks are in crisis. While the trawlers develop more and more efficient ways of filling their nets and our plates, scientists have charted a dramatic fall in numbers of fish like cod and haddock. It's a global crisis. Two-thirds of the world's fish stocks are overfished, and in a fifth of the world's fisheries, stocks have collapsed altogether. And that's exactly what's happened here, in the Irish Sea. There are so few prime white fish left in these waters that most fishermen now have to target shellfish like prawns and scallops instead. But the way these scallops are being caught is a huge cause for concern.
Part of my shtick, I guess, has always been that whatever we're eating, we should know where it comes from, we should know the story, we should know what the consequences are of us choosing to eat that thing. Now, I love to eat scallops, one of my favourite foods. But I've always had a worry about scallop dredging because you're dragging heavy gear along the bottom of the sea and it's having a destructive effect on the seafloor.
The scallop dredging industry has always been guarded about their methods. They've repeatedly refused to let me film scallop dredges working underwater. But recently, some video footage has surfaced which reveals for the first time what actually happens when the dredging gear hits the seabed. The steel teeth at the front of the dredge dig about an inch and a half into the seafloor, raking up the scallops which are collected in a heavy chain bag dragging behind it. The problem is, anything else in its path, from animals like octopus and starfish, to corals and marine plants, get ploughed up too. Here on the Isle of Man, they've recognised the problem and they're doing something about it. Over the last 20 years, they've been closing areas of the sea to fishing so the seabed can recover from scallop dredging. I want to see what effect this is having on the underwater environment. So I'm going diving with marine biologist Professor Callum Roberts.
Hi, Steve.
And local dive boat operator Steve Cowley. We'll be visiting one of the oldest marine protected areas, then heading off to a part of the sea nearby which is regularly fished for scallops. Our first dive is in Port Erin Bay, where all fishing for scallops has been banned since 1989.
That'll do. Full stop. Clear.
Can you hear me, Callum? Can you hear me?
I can hear you. I can hear you.
What do you make of the seafloor here?
Well, the seabird is absolutely covered in living creatures. They're not very spectacular to look at from a distance, perhaps, but once you get close up, they just look amazing.
When you start looking, there's really an astonishing diversity and just really abundant, isn't it? There's so much going on here.
I can see a little octopus here as well, just right in front of us.
How fantastic.
Beautiful creature. What an experience. Are all of these little indentations on the seabed, those are all occupied by great scallops.
The sheer number and size is astonishing. But I guess that's doing great things for the scallop fishery around.
Some of them are just enormous as well. They're almost dinner plate size.
I have to say, this is one of the most exciting dives I've ever done in the UK. I've just never seen such diversity and abundance on the seafloor in England before.
Look, there's a shoal of pollock over there. They're good-sized ones as well.
It's great to be on this patch, but a little worrying to think that it is just a little patch. Now, there really isn't very much of this sort of seafloor left around our coast.
That was amazing.
It was incredible.
Yeah, absolutely
stunning. The whole seabed was alive with all kinds of things, not the least the enormous scallops down there.
The biggest scallops I've ever seen and the thickest number of them as well.
Yes.
You know, you just see this is how the seafloor's meant to be.
Steve then takes us to our second dive site outside the protected zone. And it turns out that one of the local boats has decided to come and dredge for scallops in exactly the same place.
Bit of an interesting situation here, Callum, because we're on the point of going into the water to look at brown that's been dredged, and here comes a scallop dredger and he's towing his gear right now. I mean, he can see we're here, he can see we're in dive kit. Is he still moving in our direction?
He is, yes.
Coming right past us.
Right past him.
You're right, Hugh.
What do you think's going on there, Stevie?
Well, he's just hauled his catch and I've got a fairly good idea where he's been, so I think we can pretty much go and dive in his tracks, I think.
So what's the vibe been like about us coming here to try and film this?
Frosty?
Really?
I was told not to do it, pure and simple.
Why?
By the fishermen. I'm not entirely sure why. We all know that scallop dredging destroys the seabed. I guess some of the hardliners don't want it advertised.
After a couple of hours of dragging his gear round our boat, the skipper finally heads back to port.
It's only going to be light for another couple of hours, but we'll get in the water and we'll see what he's been doing this afternoon.
It looks like we've landed right on the tracks, doesn't it?
Yes, you can see them running along the seabed here.
Look at this. It's like a motorway going straight across the sand. It's like a bulldozer's just pushed its way through. What's absolutely astonishing is that there is no life down here at all. It's an absolute desert.
It's extraordinary. I mean, this is a seabed that has been scraped clean. This couldn't be more different from the last dive.
There's no other word for it than desert, really.
I'm amazed. I just wasn't prepared for this.
Look, one little scallop, that's the first one I've seen.
Oh!
Just a baby.
One little tiny scallop.
Lucky to escape.
I haven't seen a single fish yet either.
Yeah.
It wouldn't take more than a couple of weeks of dredging in that marine reserve to convert it into something that looked much like this.
Sand and stones. Sand and stones, as far as the eye can see.
Whew. I didn't expect that much nothing, you know. It's the only way I can put it, really.
Yeah. Well, we've seen how hard the scallop fisherman has been working this afternoon, just towing backwards and forwards across this patch of seabed. And I think he must have taken just about everything that was there.
Yeah. I guess the most shocking thing of all, really, is to think that almost all the seafloor around here is like that, and just a tiny amount of it is the marine reserve, and it's the wrong way round.
That's true. What we need is to fill the sea with many, many more marine protected areas like the one we saw this morning.
Yeah, and join them up. I mean,
join them up.
A chain around the nation.
Exactly.
The contrast is so much more stark and frankly scary than I imagined it could possibly be. You could probably count the number of living things that we saw on the second dive on two hands, whereas we saw literally thousands of living things in the marine reserve. And we've done that. What we've done historically is we've taken the life we saw on the marine reserve and trashed it all around our coast. The bottom line is there's so much at stake here. You know, we can preserve more and more of our coast and build up its health and richness and diversity, or we can just sort of shrug and let it go. And pretty soon there will be bugger all left, you know.
I'm on the Isle of Man, looking at the damage that scallop dredgers do to the seabed. But I've also seen how well the seabed can recover if it's protected. And this protected area is not just good for conservation, it's good for the local fishermen. The seabed has become a safe haven for fish and shellfish to reproduce in. Millions of tiny scallop offspring spread with the tides and currents, restocking even the dredged areas of the sea.
Hi there. I think we've got ourselves a bunch of scallop fishermen here. We'll have a chat. How are you?
How are you doing?
Good to meet you.
How do you?
Some hauls you'll haul for no scallops. You think, oh, there's no scallops here. But leave it for a couple of weeks. You'll go back and you get your scallops again.
So would you say that one of the reasons your fishing is so good is because you're protecting some of the sea around the island?
We know it, yeah, definitely.
We're catching as much now at the end of our season as what we were catching at the start of a season 30 years ago.
Yeah.
That's a factor.
There's a model here that others could follow, isn't it? If you protect a good part of your sea, that'll feed the rest of your fishery, you get more back.
Certainly seems to have proved it round here.
If you make the fishing as good as what it has been, they're going to come from all over the country. You know, maybe they should be thinking of doing the same in their own waters, they wouldn't have to come.
That's exactly it, isn't it?
Here on the Isle of Man, these scallopers acknowledge the damage that dredging does, but they're also being proactive by supporting marine protected areas. The same cannot be said for the rest of Britain, where scallop dredgers and beam trawlers carry on demolishing huge swathes of the seabed around our coast.
It can be so dispiriting, the problem of the oceans. But one of the things that keeps driving me forward is that it is solvable. You know, we're not talking about world peace or human mortality. No, this is a problem with real, practical solutions that can be applied. And one of the major ones that all marine conservationists agree on is marine reserves. There is not nearly enough of our sea being protected. People don't really know this. A lot of people assume that there is a lot of protection around the UK waters. And I'm going to find out what sort of assumptions are being made compared to what's actually needed.
Hello.
A lovely summer's day in Lyme Regis seems like the ideal chance to test out my theories.
Come and play Hughes Marine Protection Game. Don't be shy, roll up, roll up. What percentage of the Earth's surface is covered by ocean?
Yeah, I think it's about 75.
75.
Everybody knows this. Roughly three quarters. It's actually 71% of the world's surface is covered by sea.
Okay.
Here's a different question. What percentage of the world's oceans are fully protected? Marine reserve, no commercial exploitation at all.
I'm going to go low. Say about 25%.
Maybe 10 to 15%.
Oh my goodness.
As little as that.
Yeah.
The real figure?
I'm afraid.
No!
It's just less than 1%. What do you think of that?
I think that's awful.
Absolutely ridiculous.
Okay, well, maybe things will perk up closer to home, because I'm going to flip the board. What percentage of seas around the UK do you think are fully protected? Are we doing better than the rest of the world?
I should say it's more protected than probably.
We're doing better than the rest of the world, maybe. And leave it at about 10%.
I think between 5 and 10.
I'm going to go for 5%. 5%.
Okay, well, I have to move it again this way a bit. And less than 2, less than 1.
Oh, that's really good.
This way. In fact, as close to the zero as I can get, really, because the actual figure is 0.001.
That's terrible.
That's 1/1000th of a percent.
Yeah.
I knew things were bad, but as a percentage, it's quite shocking.
I agree.
Yeah.
And if you were in charge, if you were our fisheries minister, how much of our sea would you like to protect?
Well, a hell of a lot more than that.
20%, all the way.
Maybe 12%?
If we could have 12% protected tomorrow, I think that'd be a wonderful thing.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, we're not up with you, we're back down here at 1/1000th of a percent. Thank you for playing the game. I'm sorry if it's made you depressed.
Yeah, well, just a bit.
Yeah, well,
thanks a lot. Cheers. Cheers, guys. Good to see you. People make assumptions about the levels of protection in the ocean, and a lot of the assumptions they make are actually at around the levels that conservationists think we should be protecting. So that's 10, 20, 30%. Those assumptions are way off, and the amount we're protecting is nothing like that much, and it's nowhere near enough. And if I can take a crumb of encouragement from this mad game I've played this afternoon, it's that people want to do something about it.
Hallo, wie vielleicht einige wissen, mein Name ist Tim Melzer und wir befinden uns heute hier zum Launch-Event zu Tims Fischfight direkt vom Bundestag in Berlin.
People everywhere are more and more worried about the state of the oceans.
Signé la petition!
Los cocineros están haciendo recetas con esos pescados que normalmente se van por la borda.
In the last year, the Fish Fight campaign has spread all across Europe and the world. Our online army of fish fighters is now 850,000 strong. And I'm convinced that if we all work together, we can pressure our governments into setting up more marine protected areas. People power is already proving effective in reforming the crazy situation of discards. The infamous practice of throwing away prime edible fish back into the sea, dead. Luckily, the EU Fisheries Commissioner herself, Maria Damanaki, is determined to implement the discards ban.
Do you think the message of European citizens, over 750,000 fish fighters, has also been heard by the ministers?
Absolutely, this is for sure. So, we have to be sure that at the end of the line, the discard ban is going to be implemented.
And our own fisheries minister, Richard Bennion, is doing his bit to keep the ban on track. But every round of talks brings a new threat to progress. Some ministers oppose the ban and would like to see the proposals dropped. The problem is that many fleets have learnt to use discards to their advantage. It allows them to maximise profits by throwing away less marketable species and keeping only the most valuable fish for landing. The whole principle of conservation goes overboard too. But our ever-growing army of fish fighters has kept up the pressure on the politicians via Twitter and Facebook. And we've launched a bold newspaper campaign aimed to keep Europe's fisheries ministers on their toes. and prevent the discards ban getting buried by Brussels bureaucracy. Over 800,000 fish fight supporters in Europe are watching you. Please don't let us down.
It's 8 o'clock on Wednesday the 13th of June. The news headlines this morning. Fisheries ministers have agreed that Europe should ban the controversial policy of discarding fish that exceed quotas.
Fisheries ministers have finally bowed to public outrage over the waste of edible fish tossed overboard
public outrage
because they don't fit within the fishing group's quota. They agreed a ban on discards with provisional dates. It follows this huge campaign, of course, by Hugh Fearnley Whittingstall, and it's really resounded through Europe.
This gives me so much hope. If public pressure from our army of fish fighters can help push a discards ban through the maze of European legislation, then maybe it can persuade our own government to do something even more vital for our seas. And that, quite simply, is to give us more marine protected areas. Now. If we're going to preserve the future richness and productivity of our seas, we're going to have to be bold and act quickly. Of course, it's not just in the UK where aggressive fishing techniques are destroying marine habitats. In Southeast Asia, catch rates have declined by 90% over the past 40 years. But as they face up to the prospect of their fish stocks collapsing, some countries are coming up with effective solutions.
I've come to the Philippines because I've heard that there are some really good things happening here around the coast. Apparently there's a really enlightened approach to marine reserves and using them to build up the health of the marine environment. There's also some really bad things happening, destructive fishing practices, bad habits that go back for generations. So you could say this is really a place of extremes, and I'm hoping I can learn from both ends of the spectrum.
Fish is the main source of protein for people living in the Philippines. So it's perhaps not surprising that these are some of the most overfished waters on the planet. And it's not just conventional fishing techniques which are contributing to the crisis.
I'm on my way to an island, a quite remote island, on the edge of the Philippine archipelago, where for quite some time now they've been using a very controversial fishing technique. It's quite popular around coral reefs all over Asia because it's so devastatingly effective. But it's highly unsustainable and pretty much everywhere in the world now, illegal.
I've promised not to reveal the name of this island, where I've arranged to meet a local boatman, Rolando Cowett, who's agreed to introduce me to some outlaw fishermen.
Hi, I'm Hugh. Hi. How are you? Hi there. So this is where the fishing starts?
Yeah. They put the fertilizer in a gas, gasoline.
Diesel. That's what the same as the engine runs on?
Yeah.
What they're making is a crude form of dynamite.
I have to say, this is so far removed from anything I've experienced before that I just don't know what might happen. They've got diesel and fertilizer in a frying pan over a naked flame. I suppose what's encouraging is that, you know, they've all got their hands and fingers and eyebrows, as far as I can tell, and they've done this presumably many, many times before, so I'm just going to go with it. He's just lit a cigarette. So they're filling up the bottles now. And is this process dangerous? Could that explode here?
No, no. Because without blasting up, it's not dangerous too.
Oh my God, he's putting it in now. Okay, so now it's quite dangerous.
Yeah.
Now if we light that, bang.
Blast.
Okay.
Thank you. first light the next day, I join Rolando and the Dynamite Boys on what feels like the most dangerous fishing trip of my life. Even if we escape without blast injuries, there's a mandatory 18-month prison sentence if the authorities show up. So I can't help but feel a little bit nervous about the whole thing.
One of the guys is in the water with a mask looking for a good shoal of fish. And they've got their dynamite standing by. My God, here comes a big bubble. That's extraordinary. He barely got out of the water, he just lifted his feet up the side of the boat. You can see this big ball here, this big ball of completely still water. That's the ripple effect of the bomb going off. He's gone in right in front of the boat. You feel the shock of the blast even from over here, about 30 yards away. They're chucking the anchor of their boat in now. So I really need to get in there and see what's going on.
Okay, we're just coming to that part of the reef where I think most of the dead fish are. Here comes one of the guys with his net and his extraordinary homemade fins. They're working incredibly fast to pick these fish up. Breathing through these narrow tubes. They've just got a bit of the tube stuffed in the corner of their mouths and it goes back to the compressor on the boat. I find it challenging enough to be down here with full scuba gear. It just doesn't look safe. These are the guys that they targeted. I think they saw quite a big shoal of these fusiliers. I'm not sure if they would say they'd hit the jackpot, but there's certainly a lot of fish here. Normally when there's a bit of fishing going on, I like to get involved. But on this occasion, it seems a bit strange. I'm not sure how I feel about being complicit in the dynamiting of a reef. But having said that, I really don't see anything that looks like serious damage to the reef itself. The fish are lying fairly thick on the ground, but the coral doesn't really seem to have been disturbed. There you go. Let's not waste any, now that they're dead.
I've got a little curious bunch of mixed feelings, really. Respect for these guys, for their skill and, frankly, their bravery going down with those tubes. But also, I am anxious about the long-term effect of this kind of fishing. Because I didn't see many big fish down there. In fact, apart from the fish we picked up, even on the fringes of where the bomb went off, I hardly saw any fish at all.
Hundreds of miles away from the Dynamite Boys, in the waters around Cebu City, the long-term effects of blast fishing have reached crisis point. This was once one of the busiest fisheries in the Philippines. But today, the sea is almost deserted. Local dive master Edgar Estrera is going to show me why.
Edgar, what is this patch out here? What are we going to go and look at?
Yeah, we're here in supposed to be a good coral reef, but sadly, lately, there's been a lot of dynamite fishing that's been damaging the reefs and driving out all the fishes.
The dynamite fishing that I've looked at before, I think they were deliberately detonating the bomb quite close to the surface.
Yes.
So it was a downward blast on a shoal of fish.
Yeah.
But sometimes these guys actually deliberately let the bomb go into the coral to get the big fish out of the coral, do they?
Yes. It damages the corals when there are no corals, no more fish. And maybe it's just good only for this generation. The next or the coming generations would be left with a few or nothing.
Well, there is some coral down here. It's quite patchy and there's quite a lot of broken coral. It's kind of like a crater, really. Not entirely unexpected, as a bomb has in fact gone off down here. Edgar's just showing me the blast damage. There's a hole in the coral reef here. This is another blast crater. This is an even bigger one. This must be maybe 10 meters across. This blast may have happened a while ago because there's some small growth of soft corals happening in the middle of it. But the problem on this reef is that it's been dynamited so often that there are simply no fish left. The coral that hasn't been bombed, some of it's in quite good nick. And where you see a good coral, you expect to see fish. I mean, so far, I can count the fish that I've seen on this reef on one hand, and I've been down here 5 minutes already. I've just brushed past a fire coral. It stung me quite badly. It's quite painful. That's going to stink for the rest of the day. Well, I think I've had enough of this rather depressing dive. Let's hope I can find somewhere more inspiring, not too far away.
It's hard to imagine a more destructive method of catching fish. And the sea here looks to me like a terrifying vision of a future without any fish at all. But just across the bay, something different is happening. 7 years ago, the Tolima Marine Sanctuary was set up, one of a network of over 1,000 small but effective marine protected areas. They're helping to bring fish stocks back from the brink all around these islands.
Let's get in the water.
Just as we're getting ready to take a look, Edgar hails a couple of passing fishing boats.
Ikaw yung mga nai sanctuary? Nidaganda rin isda tungod nga nai sanctuary or... Oh, lagi.
Edgar, what's the story from these fishermen? What have they been telling you?
They're going to fish outside this reserve. They like this spot.
And they're allowed to fish there? That's just outside the reserve?
Yes, they are. They usually fish here using fish nets. Then the others will like drive the fish.
So drive the fish into the nets?
Yeah.
By diving?
Yeah.
I'd love to see that.
Free dive, yes.
Great. So maybe when we've had our dive, we can go and catch up with them and have a chat with them.
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Wow. Fish at last. What a treat. And so many of them. I can see snappers over to my left. Angelfish in front of me, several different types. And look at that fat snapper. He must be 4 or 5 kilos. Wow. And there's an old wreck here. Just a small one. So nice to be down among the fish at last. And look at that fantastic shoal of surgeon fish coming right up to my mast. So many fish and so friendly. Just shows that this is a healthy marine environment and that the marine reserve is working. Lots of healthy coral, tons of fish. And that's exactly what making a marine reserve is all about. Building up the fish stocks
and allowing a spillover into the surrounding areas, which the local fishermen can benefit from. And I'm sure that's what's happening right here. It's great.
Ah, what a great dive.
While I've been underwater getting lovey-dovey with the fish, our new fisherman friends just outside the marine reserve have been doing their best to catch some.
The question I have to ask first is, why are you wearing this stuff on your head?
I know you're not going to use
the
lobes in your hand.
Is it the sun?
Jellyfish stings.
Okay. Do you realise it makes you look quite scary? It's a kind of zombie look. Are you happy with your catch this morning?
Yes.
And why do you like fishing close to the marine reserve?
They are benefited with the size of the touch near the because of the marine reserves.
Okay. My fishing friends have invited me on board for the next throw of the net, and that is not an invitation I'm going to pass up. Nice fins.
Scaring fish into a net by splashing might not be the most efficient method of fishing, but it is kind of fun. And a lot less destructive than dynamite fishing. And at the end of the day, these guys can put a meal on their family's tables. These are some of the most overfished seas on the planet. You know, they've been dynamited, they've been overfished for decades to the point where all these fisheries are on the brink. And yet this morning I've met a bunch of subsistence fishermen scratching a living for their families who fully understand and appreciate the benefits of a well-placed marine reserve in the middle of their fishery. So I'm going back to say we need to do this. We've got so much to protect and so much to gain from having our own chain of marine reserves around the UK. Let's get on with it. I think it's high time the British public knew what's going on under the sea, all around our coast. So I've come to Western Supermare, where I'm planning something which I hope will open people's eyes to the need for more marine protected areas. The huge problem with marine conservation is the invisibility. It's out there where you can't see it. So what I wanted to do today was bring the reef onto the beach. It's a lovely sunny day, it's the summer holidays, there should be loads of people here, and I want them to, you know, appreciate what's out there. And then, a little bit later on this afternoon, send perhaps a different kind of message. Hi, Nicola.
Hello, Hugh.
How's it going?
Yeah, not too bad, thank you.
That is a beautiful flatty.
Thank you very much.
Award-winning sand sculptor Nicola Wood and her team have spent the last 3 days building a model of a healthy underwater habitat here on the beach.
We've tried as best we can to recreate a British seabed. We've got some living creatures, some stones, some rocks, some coral.
Ah, is this a massive conger eel?
It is indeed.
If I was diving, I'm not sure I'd want to see one that big. Blimey, and I wouldn't want to see an octopus this big, but that is fantastic. I think you're stunning, Nicola.
Thank you very much, Hugh. That's
really, really
that's
great.
Great to hear.
So, Callum, the seabed is now on the beach.
It looks wonderful. It's recreating the kind of topography that we would expect to find underwater.
Marine biologist Professor Callum Roberts is on hand to help me add some more texture and colour to the seabed.
Well, we have a job now, which is this is the hard sea floor, and in these boxes we've got sea creatures and soft corals and fans and all that kind of thing.
That's right, yeah. Twiglets, very similar to the coralline seaweeds which create mirl beds. We could tuck some crabs in on this reef.
You know how they like to burrow in a little bit? Sea fans.
That's right.
And what about these grapes, Callum?
Well, they could represent sea squirts. They're about the same sort of consistency as a grape, so if you were to run something over a sea squirt, it would get split. A few sea urchins, yeah? I think they would just be stuck in little clusters here.
In our seafloor on the beach, flowers and ferns take the place of seaweeds and sponges.
Nicola and her team have taken the best part of 3 days to put all this together. But how long would it take out there in the sea for this sort of marine habitat to develop?
Really more than a century, I think. A lot of the animals that live on these reefs are very slow growing, and there's a succession like there is in a forest.
We have lost a huge amount of pristine marine habitat, but what chance is there of recovery?
In any place that's been protected from mobile fishing gears being swept up and down along the seabed, it's begun to come back almost immediately.
And then slowly, slowly, this kind of stuff can come back eventually.
It will develop over a period of decades.
We've got quite a few people gathered already. If they don't know what a pristine, rich marine habitat looks like, have we created a reasonable shot at one up here on the beach?
I think we have, and if anything, we've underrepresented the abundance and richness that you would get underwater. You know, if you were to look at...
You're saying I didn't spend enough money in the garden centre.
You could have filled it, yes.
Yeah. Hi there. Who is he? Very good question. What is going on? He's some nutter who's concerned about fish. Roll up! Roll up! Come and see the Fish Fight Marine Reserve here on the beach. Come on, don't get cozy. We brought the seabed onto the beach here today. Come and see what we're up to. The show starts in 5 minutes. We're over here. It's effort. Make an effort. You might not know it, but we have some of the most rich, diverse and exciting marine habitats on the planet right here around the coast of Britain. Or at least we used to. But we haven't, to be honest, looked after them as well as we might. But in order to give you just a little impression of how amazing the seafloor can be, we've recreated a little scene on the beach here today. So please have a look around. Soak it all up, take it all in. Because in a moment, we're going to do to this seafloor what's happening out there in the real sea, day after day. About 3 tons, this beam trawl rig over here. And also, we've got some very, very heavy metal here on the scallop dredges. Okay, it's simply not realistic to imagine that these very effective forms of commercial fishing are going to disappear forever. But I think certain areas should be protected from that sort of activity. Because when it happens, well, you're about to see what happens when it happens. And there you have it, ladies and gentlemen. With the double scallop dredge and the beam trawl gone through, there's not a whole lot left. It's a big problem. But there is a solution, and that is adequate marine reserves to fully protect the richness and diversity of the environment. And one thing that's going to make a huge difference is public pressure. So if you're ready to get behind this campaign, I'd like to hear a big cheer from you now. Are we going to do it?
Yeah!
Because you all really can make a difference. Cheers, everybody. Thank you. Thank you very much. What did you think of what you saw here this afternoon?
It had a big impact.
It certainly made me think about it. Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah. A bit of an eye-opener, really.
Made me feel bad.
Yeah.
Would you feel better if you knew that there were more marine reserves out there?
Yes,
would it make
absolutely.
You worry less about this kind
yeah,
of fishing?
Absolutely.
You just can't believe we're an island, and yet we're just ignoring all the sea that's around us.
To find out more about my campaign to establish new marine protected areas, go to our website at fishfight.net. And on Monday, February the 25th at midday, I'll be leading a march across Westminster Bridge to the Houses of Parliament. Come and join us. We'll be filming it for the third programme. Next time, I'll be taking my fish fight further than I've ever been before.
Oh, that is my first ever whale.
To the frozen southern oceans of Antarctica.
Here we go. Whoa! Fantastic food for penguins, whales, and who knows, maybe in the future, human beings.
To find out more about the issues raised in the programme and getting involved, go to channel4.com/fishfight. Well, next here on 4, from disappearing fish stocks to a disappearing wardrobe, what makes Scouser and world's most prolific streaker Mark Roberts unable to keep his clothes on?